thank everyone for being here again. How to Be a YouTube Rockstar with Carlin Hines. So, Carlin, welcome, sir. How are you? Testing microphone.
Yeah, forgive me.
There he goes.
I wanted to thank you firstly for being so kind and so consistent for over the years, because I was just somebody in the audience who learned. And I said, this is my time to finally add value back. So YouTube, I'm going to get straight to it because I just am that type of guy. So, you know, I think my current subscribers is somewhere near 950K. It was kind of sitting around 920K for a while until I had a viral short where literally I had averaged around like 6,000 subscribers a month. And literally, if you have one viral short that you have tested and proven that works across all the platforms, this short has gone viral. Not viral, but it's gained views on Instagram, YouTube, TikTok. So it let me know that that is a winner. If you look at my Social Blade, this is a website for you guys. So I think I can type in the chat. So I'll just put stuff in the chat. Socialblade.com. So if I speak too fast, just try to clip it and save it. Because again, if you're going out, Dr. Finance, and we're going out with a bang. This is going to be as much value as I can add. So I'm going to share you all my tools for the credentials. Again, 950-something thousand. We're headed to 1 million soon, God willing. I think 160 million views on YouTube. You know, that's subtracting the millions that I deleted from my older videos. You know, even just to prove that this is more than one platform, you know, even on Instagram, I think, if you total up all our views, it's like 220 something million, or now it's probably 250 or somewhere around there. I haven't recently counted. And you know, if stuff works on TikTok, you know, I'm cross platform. I've grown a Discord to be the second Discord in my niche in the world, with 61,000 folks in there, I think. And I think the leading one is 136, but what I'm saying is that the techniques I'm going to give you today apply to all platforms. I've done it on TikTok. I have 1 million likes on TikTok. I've done it on Twitter, not so much, but Facebook. We've gotten multiple millions of views on Facebook. What other platforms? Instagram, I've grown 100,000 100,000 followers in, I think, under a year. I forget exactly the time frame, but I remember I went hard back in September. And what else did we do? You know, and then however many YouTube subscribers. So this is tested information. It always works. The key, though, and I'm going to give you the hardest part first, is that you have to, if you are going to start, because I started an anonymous channel to see if this stuff works. And what I realized is that I was not consistent on my anonymous channel because I didn't correlate effort to results. And what I mean by that is, in the beginning, you may be discouraged because you can't put your links to your website in your video description. You might not be able to monetize right away. And there's something about, regardless of what your belief about money is, it's something about a reward tied to effort that helps us keep going. You know, I have a fiance who's upstairs with our child, and, you know, the time we spend, I get rewarded. You know, it's like I put in all this work in the business so that there's a reward at the end of the day. So if you don't have that reward, it's very hard to train yourself to be consistent. So the platform's not going to train you. You have to create your own reward. Your reward could be different. Whatever makes you happy, just whenever you complete an action in this sequence, try to reward yourself with that specific thing so that you're programming your brain to consistently do it. Because the biggest thing I see is people not doing it more it long enough and doing enough. So let's say my goal is 6 million views a month. Okay, if you total up all your video views and then divide it by the total amount of videos, I have 5,000 videos almost, and we have 160 million views. If you do the math and just divide the amount of views by the amount of videos, you'll get how many views you get per video. So I think my average is somewhere around 37,000. Okay, so that's important because when you're writing a goal, you have to know how hard you have to work. And an example I give is that if I'm shooting foul shots and I want to make 1,000 foul shots, unless I'm Kobe and I just nail every single foul shot, that means I'm going to have to shoot a lot more than 1,000 to make 1,000. And this is where a lot of people don't do enough when it comes to YouTube. So if I'm a 33% shooter, you know, when it comes to foul shots, that means I actually have to take 3,300 shots in order to make 1,000. And that's the tricky part. Again, so, you know, once you get started, you need to measure your accuracy, whether that's conversion accuracy, whether that's how many views you get per video accuracy, whatever the thing you're trying to improve, you need to measure your accuracy. So you can't write goals until you have that accuracy. Okay, so let's say you want 1 million views per month. Okay, let's divide that by your average video count. I think Dr. Finance, yours was up near 80,000, which is almost three times mine. So if he wanted to hit 1 million, you know, I'm doing rough mental math. I didn't do so well in calculus, so bear with me. Actually, I have a phone and I'm gonna use a calculator. So 1 million divided by, 80,000? That means he would have to publish 12 videos a month in order to hit his target, at least 12.5 videos to hit his target. So again, that's the hardest part. Now let's get into the tactics, okay? So here's some things I've noticed is when it comes to YouTube, you gotta be salacious, if that's even like the proper word, I don't even know, but you gotta use hyperbole. And if you don't know anything about copywriting, try going to Men's Health, if you have a primarily male audience or identifies as male audience, and try going to Cosmopolitan if you have a primarily identifies as a woman audience. And this is because they speak two different languages. Okay, and what you can literally do if you have no idea how to write copy, I know we have ChatGPT now, but you know, the guys at menshealth.com and Cosmopolitan get paid a lot of money to get people to click on that title. Because what's the first thing people see when they go to your YouTube? It's your thumbnail and it's your title. So if those two don't stand up, you know, and get beyond what's called the 5% click-through rate that YouTube needs in order to push it to the homepage, it will never grow. And I know you hear this a lot, but nobody gave you the tactical science. So if you go to cosmopolitan.com for women and then go to menshealth.com for people who identify as male, then you'll, you know, take their title, literally just take it. It says top 6 ways to gain abs before the summer's end or something like that. Now go to Google Trends and I want you to search up your trend searches and then narrow it down to the, the category. So everybody here seems like they're in a different category. My category is entertainment specifically. So, you know, they talk about different things, whether it's Travis Scott, Kylie Jenner, The Weeknd, Drake, whatever the names are, those are your keywords. So what you do is you get the structure from a Men's Health or a Cosmopolitan.com by copying their title. You paste it into a Google Doc. Then you go over to Google Trends and you get the keywords. And all you have to do is literally swap out the keyword. So instead of the top 6 ways to get abs before the summer's end, I go the top 6 ways to get Travis Scott bass, you know, whatever ties to your specific niche. And all I have to do is use that keyword because that's what people understand. The biggest mistake we tend to make, especially in the education field, and I'm going to get into particulars in a second, is that we assume that people know the lingo, the lexicon. There's a book, Social Code, and I forget who wrote the book, forgive me, but if you type in Social Code and then Medium, which is a website, like a blog type website, it will give you about 8 things that create community. And one of those things is lexicon. And we all have different dictionaries. You know, if I say the word ice cream, everybody here has a completely different 2 words that they associate with the words ice cream. Some might say cold, some might say vanilla, some might say Ben and Jerry's. We all have a completely different dictionary for the word ice cream. I'm studying Python for AI coding, and I'm realizing how important the dictionary actually is, the concept of a dictionary, how we define words. And so when you go to Google Trends, for example, you're looking at the world's most common language. You know, for somebody who might not even understand English, that's all they know is the celebrity, because that is their, you know, some people worship celebrity, but that's all they know is the celebrity. Then you can get into the granular stuff as you scale on your specific website or your email sequence and all that type of stuff. So what I'm saying is introduce people to the brownie and then explain to them how there's medicine in the brownie and the medicine does this and the medicine does that. We make the mistake of putting the medicine first and then wondering why nobody wants the brownie. And that's the hugest mistake that I see. So let's get into the science. There's 2 types of content. You have interruption-based content. And if you're in this type of world, you have to master click-through rate. And that's the only world that I've seen. The only way that I've seen. So interruption-based content, and then you have educational content. So I'm, you know, I kind of play on the interruption-based stuff in a way, but really my channel is educational-based, which means it's search-based. Okay, so what I'm setting right now is your expectation for what to expect when you hop onto YouTube. If you hop on YouTube right now and make a video how to stir up or how to create a unique macaroni and cheese, that sounds cool. But the problem is you only get as much search that happens through Google. And so the way you research this is going to Google Keyword Planner and just looking up your specific keyword and seeing how much organic traffic is there even in the market. How many people are actually searching how to make organic macaroni and cheese or whatever I said. I forgot what I said. So you're capped. There's a market cap to search volume, whereas interruption-based content doesn't have a market cap. It's cross-platform. It's cross-genre. It's kind of like, you know, in hip-hop, at least the hip-hop culture, you have R&B, like you're, I don't know, who's a popular, this is what I'm saying, like I say R&B, but who's popular to you? If you say country, who's popular to me? I don't know all the country guys. So even on that level, you know, R&B, Usher, he's R&B. But then you get into styles like neo-soul. You might not know what neo-soul, you may have never heard of it, but Music Soul Child could be neo-soul. And then, you know, D'Angelo or whoever. And all I'm saying is that when you go pop, like how Usher did, and all the like dance stuff, that's when he crossed over into all these other folks, because you have to create a commonality between the audience that you're trying to attract. So the audience that most of us attract is just based on how we currently resonate, which is with our story. But think about your audience like the United States of America. We have the United States of America. It's 300 million people or so. Then what's the next thing that divides people? Usually it's skin tone. Okay, and I'm not doing this to like race bait or anything. I'm just saying this is usually what divides people. And then you have religion. And then what do you have under religion? You have states. And then under states you have counties, and then you have church, and then you have specific communities. So when you have somebody who's trying to master and take over the market, you know, for a local corner store, it's like, okay, you can't expect 10 million people to come to your local corner store, but I can expect 10 million people to know what Walmart is because Walmart is everywhere. My point is you have to understand that there's a cap depending on which niche you're going for. So don't beat yourself up if you're not getting millions of views. It's because you're not broadcasting to the right audience, if that makes sense. So you just have to determine what your outcome is. Now, I want to make it clear, I'm not a YouTuber per se. I'm somebody who leveraged YouTube to drive traffic to my actual business, whereas most people kind of create a YouTube career. And I just want to make that very clear that, you know, the techniques I'm showing you are not specifically how to get locked into YouTube. Now, there's caveats here, so I got to be careful. So let's go back to the two types of content. You have interruption-based content and you have education content. The education content, your only goal, your only purpose is to solve a problem. That is literally the only reason why your video exists, if we break it down all the way to the core. Because if I say how to tie my shoes, it's because I have a problem learning how to tie my shoes or knowing how to tie my shoes. The only reason I'm looking it up is to solve that problem. So if you can't get that equation right and get the actual answer for your specific problem that you're trying to solve, you know, this is where a lot of people get limited and they can't fake it, because when it comes to education and stuff like this, you have to be an actual expert of the field. And I think that's where a lot of people get caught up. They reach a cap because they realize they can't solve all the problems because they're not true experts in that field. And in that case, just go study. I'm not discouraging anybody. But let's talk about interruption based. There's a book by Robert Cialdini called Influence. I'm sure a lot of you guys know about it because you guys are like the top tier people in the world, like not just here, but in the world. So what we use are psychological triggers to get people to click. And I have a list I can send to Dr. Finance. And the main thing, though, you want to focus on is mystery, because there's four levels of a content consumer. Okay, there's four levels. So this is probably an important concept to hammer down. Is the first level is a spectator. And the only goal of a spectator, the only purpose is to watch your stuff or to know about you. That's it. Now, the next level is called a skeptic. Okay, a skeptic's job is to question and seek flaw. We humans tend to have a desire to seek about what's wrong in something or what's wrong about someone. And so that's our first instinct, is to look for what's wrong. I guess because we don't have time to sit there and, like McGinna said, you know, go through the paperwork and all the filings and make sure their business is tight and do all these things. We just have to go off our gut and, you know, quick trust. Do we trust this person? Yes, no. We don't have time to research. And I think the same thing with humans. So we seek for flaw. Then the third level of a content consumer is your subscriber. Now, your subscriber's goal and purpose is to watch your stuff, share your stuff, comment, like, okay? Now, what most people get frustrated with when it comes to social media is they expect a spectator to do what the subscriber does. And they're going to be constantly beating themselves up because they don't understand that there's tiers to how people perceive you and how they operate and engage with you. So what I'm going to show you is how to convert people from one step to the next step. And the fourth step, if you're following along, is the supporter. Now, the supporter takes out their hard-earned dollars out their pocket and gives it, and gives it to you so that, one, you can sustain your business, but also so that you can expand the spectatorship, because we all have this community desire in our DNA. Okay, so there's four levels. Let's go back to the beginning. I'll show you how to convert that levels, okay? Is the first level is that spectator. This is a person who only watches. Now, your goal is to create mystery, because when you create mystery, you create the question in people's heads. And when you ask a question, people stop to actually think and take action. Whether you think thinking is an action or thinking is not an action, the fact that you had somebody stop and their biology changed means they're engaging with what you had to say. So the only way that I found that's easy is to pull in people who are spectators is curiosity. It's like a cat. I live with a cat, and I can tell you that cat will find a hole to hide in. So let's move to the next step, which is the, spectator, and then moving to a skeptic. Now, once you get people in the door with the curiosity, this is where people call it clickbait. So if people say, you know, this video is clickbait, it's because once they got to that next step, they falsified what you had to offer. And what I mean by this is when you bring in the spectator, you have to make sure that whatever you're presenting is backed by facts, data, research, and just backed by something. You don't want them to find the flaw or find the fallacy in what you have to say. And so that takes a lot of accuracy that we talked about earlier. But, you know, people get frustrated, you know, when they have clickbait because they go there out of mystery and then they falsify something. Okay. And then they leave and they actually multiply the falsifiers. So you actually attract more hate that way. So again, spectator is the first step. How do we pull them in? Mystery, curiosity. How do we get them to the next level? We need to make sure that our facts are straight and that there's zero fallacy in what we have to present. A shout out to Monty who just popped back in. Thank you. And then we move from, spectator, skeptic, and then to move the skeptic to what's called a subscriber, this is where they usually go through your catalog of stuff. Now, most people think when people watch you that they're going to automatically watch five more videos of you. I can tell you that is not how most watch sessions work. Okay. And I'll get into watch sessions in a second. So again, moving from the skeptic over to the subscriber, they usually watch your catalog because they tried to seek flaw. They found none. Then they're going, wow, this person doesn't have flaw in what they're presenting in something that I'm interested in. Let me go watch three more videos. And if they can't find flaw in that, then they subscribe. Then they have the call to action moment. Okay. So moving from a subscriber, however, to a supporter is different because here we have to, you know, I'm a music guy, so I'm talking frequency here, but you know, imagine a Jesus, for example. Two of the strongest words in the Bible for me were Jesus wept. And I said, why was this so impactful? It was the first time I think I've ever saw a two-word sentence. But also, it was so powerful because it said so much in a small amount of time. And what I realized is it takes a godlike figure and humanizes a godlike figure. You know, if the character of Jesus' job is to reconcile a relationship between the creator and humans, that means he's bridging the gap between a high frequency and a low frequency, so to speak. And so when Jesus wept, it's the high frequency falling down to low frequency to be human. And so he connected the gap between creator and human in that case, or creation and creator, connects the dots. And so we have to do the same exact thing when it comes to our content. We need to humanize. And by humanize, I mean, we need to show emotion. The literal only thing, and I've studied biology and pre-med in undergrad for 4 years. So the only thing that makes us human is the fact that we have bodies to emote. Think about it. I mean, our brains can think, we can conjure up all these ideas and imagine all this stuff. But what makes us human, meaning in a body, not just a spirit being, but what makes us human is that we can emote through all the emotions. I went to a pediatrician recently for my son. He's what, 10 weeks or whatever? I don't even know. He's just growing so fast. But on the wall, there's a picture with all the emotions, and it says, how are you feeling today on the poster? And I posted it to my YouTube, so if you want a reference, you can go to myyoutube.com/busyworksbeats. And I bring that up because you have to communicate to your audience and resonate on one of those emotions for them to actually feel that you're a human. or else they just feel like you're a dictionary. And what's the point of watching you when they can open up a dictionary and read the text that has no life to it, no animation to it? And so if you literally want to separate yourself from boring, dry, dead, inanimate things, you need to emote. Okay, so Jesus wept. Just remember that. And moving forward, though, you have the supporter. And the supporter wants to go from a low frequency to a high frequency. You know, if Jesus is the person they want to be like, how do we take this human at 100 hertz and take them up to 1,000,000 hertz? And isn't that the science of how to raise your frequency, kundalini energy and all these other things? But we're talking about harmonics. And so if you study physics and harmonics, you have divisions of something. So for example, if I have a bass drum that's 100 hertz, all I have to do is multiply by 2 to find the second harmonic. So we multiply what's called a fundamental frequency. So we go from 100 hertz times 2 is our second harmonic, times 3 is our third harmonic, on and on and on. And what I'm saying is that if Jesus in this story and metaphor that I'm using is 1,000,000 hertz, he's my desired outcome. I want to raise my frequency to be like that high frequency, an extra harmonic of myself. And when you divide 1,000,000 by 100, I don't know the exact number, I think 10,000 maybe, is you get me, the person who wants to be like the 1,000,000 hertz. And so you have to draw the path between how they're going to go from where they are to where you are. And that's what converts a subscriber over to a supporter, because a supporter just wants to step into their future self. That's their desires, to get to a desired outcome. And our thing that we sell or teach or show is just a means to an end. We're not selling our thing. We're not selling courses. We're not selling books. We're not selling, what else do people sell? Merch. We're actually selling this. And I had to define value in my recent book. If you go to busyworksbeats.com/book, I wrote 2 free books and I don't like monetize them. I don't upsell. It's just books that I wanted to write. My mission here on earth is to show love, be filled with the spirit of truth, and complete my assignment. Now, my assignment is to give Bibles. Now, to give Bibles to everybody in the world, I realize it's $15 per Bible to give people a Bible around the world. That's a lot of money. I would need $1.5 billion in order to give away 100 million Bibles, which is my aspiration or my affirmation, I should say. And so I said, how can I give Bibles without actually physically giving a Bible? So I wrote a book called Producer Bible, and it goes through the mindset. It's basically reframed parables from the Bible, but phrased in modern terms. And so I'm saying all this to say, in the Producer Bible book, I define value. And so if you actually define value, it goes into the French even. I dug into the etymology, you know, even to the French meanings. And it actually means to lead people to a desired outcome. So value is when we take somebody and we convert them or lead them to a desired outcome. Now, what are those desired outcomes? Those desired outcomes are health, fitness, mastery, which is also called prevalence, social status, and power. That's what we're actually selling. We're not selling the course. We're not selling the book. We're not selling the merchandise. You know, LVMT or, you know, LVMH or whatever this acronym is, they're not selling purses. They're selling social status. Okay. So we have to figure out what is the ultimate end goal. You know, if a guy goes to the Ferrari dealership to purchase a Ferrari, he's not buying the Ferrari. He's not buying it because it has stainless steel and red color and leather seats. He's actually buying the Ferrari because he wants to attract the mate, because a Ferrari is a wealth signal of social status, to say that I have so much money that I can waste $450,000 on a machine, and it shows how much, you know, how many resources a man has to attract the mate. Because what does a woman want in this case, in the traditional sense? Security, so that she can provide for the progeny, which are the kids, aka the continuation of the genetics. So what a man is actually buying when he buys a Ferrari is not the Ferrari. He's buying the social status so that he can use it as a wealth signal to attract a mate. And he wants the mate because he wants to continue his genetics. Because when you ask, you know, wealthier folks, what's your definition of survival? It's not day-to-day living. That's not the actual definition of survival. Survival means to continue your genetics or continue your life through generations. That's the actual definition for survival. We misuse that word all the time. And so that's what he's buying, is survival of his genetics. He's buying the car as a wealth signal to attract the mate. Okay, he needs the mate to partner with so that they can have kids, because the kids are a continuation of his genetics. And then, you know, you want to set the kids up so that they can be protected to do the same thing, on and on and on. You know, what was it, a promise in the Bible? Abraham could have more kids than the stars in the sky. So that's a built-in desire for us. I think the first commandment in the Bible is be fruitful and multiply. And so that's even embedded in our DNA. So I'm saying all that to say that people do not watch our stuff for the stuff. They're watching it for some other reason, and we have to figure out why. Now, in order to convert that subscriber to a supporter, to make money off your YouTube, to have people pay to keep you up there and buy your stuff, you need to show them how you can take them and hold their hand to take them from that 100 hertz up to 1,000,000 hertz. How do we guide them to their desired outcomes of social status, health, power and prevalence, which is mastery. Okay. And that's how I upsell into my courses. I say the thing I'm actually selling is a mastery of the craft. People love to be masters. I'm learning Python coding, for example, and it's just such a joy when I learn something new, I apply it and I get it. Whether I'm coding the next Facebook or not, I'm excited because I get to learn Python. And we tend to think that we are these gatekeepers of information, but we tend to forget that not everybody wants to be the highest of the high in the field. You know, just because they're learning business doesn't mean they want to be Jeff Bezos. Just because they learn music production, it doesn't mean they want to be Timbaland or whomever. And so you have to understand that philosophy, because your goal is to sell excitement. The excitement comes from people stepping into their future self and seeing themselves through the problem that you solve. And I said all that to say, you have two main audiences. You have interruption-based, and then you have the educational approach to YouTube. And so I'm assuming most of you guys are educational-based, or if you're entertainment-based, you need to use these triggers that I'm about to give you right now. So let me pull up my notes, because if you guys search up, his name is Dan Locke, okay? And if you study Dan Locke, he has a video called like Keys to Copywriting or something along those lines. And so I took all these from his book his presentation and Robert Cialdini. So firstly, I'm going to give you a format for every video. Okay. And this also works on sales pages. I'm just going to give you the formula, because I tried to do this with a university before, going through all the triggers, and it took me like the whole time. So I got to be kind of quick with these. So if you do have a pen or want to clip this or whatever. So in the presentation of anything that we have to offer, we have a headline. This is the first thing that catches people's attention. In other words, this is your thumbnail and your title. Okay. And we'll get into how to build a thumbnail and a title in a second. Okay. So the headline is the first thing people see. And then we have an opening. Now, the goal of the opening is to keep people's attention. And I learned through, I think, Frank Kern and his marketing trainings and NLP and different things, you want to create what's called an open loop. And the way you create an open loop is you want to promise someone a desired outcome, but before you get there, and then you divert into something else, and it creates an open loop. Think of an open loop like a question you have, and then somebody changes the topic, but they forgot to answer the question, and then you come back later and you answer the question. Okay, so that's called an open loop. It's a way to keep people there. It's the same reason why when you watch people live, they say, if you watch till the end, we're going to do our giveaway. Why? Because they need to keep you there, because the open loop is, will I win this giveaway? Okay, and so you have to create different open loops. You know, a couple open loops are, if you're doing live stream, either have a big reveal at the end of your live stream, or you could do giveaways. That's a really simple way to keep people watching all the way to the end. Or in, you know, my case, I do beat battles with the top beat battlers from around the globe. And, you know, they want to be in the main event. It's kind of like, you know, a Mike Tyson fight. Like, they want to make it all the way to the end. And so they're willing to stay to see if they can even qualify for the fight. So you have to lead them to a desired outcome and just withhold it. It's kind of like a dog. You don't give a dog a treat right away if you want it to sit. You have to say, hey, King. This is my dog's name, by the way. I say, hey, King, and you hold the treat in your hand. Then you tell him a command, sit. And only until he sits do you give him the reward. And that's called an open loop. It's the anticipation for a desired outcome and a desired result. And so, going back to the beginning, I went on a little tangent, but hopefully I gave you depth there, is that the headline is the thing that gets people's attention. And that's all you're trying to do is hook people in, catch them like a fish. Okay. I'll give you those ways to do it in a second.
What are some of your top lessons from being a YouTuber, period? So what are some of your top lessons? If you could boil it down, I know you've given us so many lessons just a moment ago, but if you can boil it down in, let's say, 30 seconds, give us like your top three, like number one, number two, number three.
Yeah, the first lesson is, if you're going for sponsorships, the more you say no, the higher you're going to go. It sounds counterintuitive, but if you say yes to somebody who's a C player, the A players never want to work with you unless you have massive, massive, massive numbers. So the fact that I said no for so many years, didn't take affiliate deals, didn't take endorsements and all this stuff, then the top companies in the world want to work with me. If you go to my Twitter, I listed all my clients. I wish I had all this stuff ready, but I've worked with four billion dollar companies. One is Razer Music. We did a campaign with called Razer Music and Made with Blade. It had some of the world's top producers on it and artists on it. Deadmau5, Metro Boomin, Murda Beats, and all these other guys. Anderson .Paak might be more known by you guys. And then I work with Sweetwater, which is a music retailer. You know, Near Protocol and Web3. We've done a lot of cool stuff in the Web3 world. And then Avid, which is sold for, I think, $1.4 billion recently to, I think, STG. I'm starting to mix up all the companies, but if you look at my Twitter, I have a screenshot of all of the clients that I have. Universal Audio, Native Instruments, FabFilter, Entourace, ImageLine, Serato Waves, TuneCore, Atom Audio, IK Multimedia, Arturia, Isotope, IK Professional, all these innovation. And my point is, once you get that ball rolling, everybody else follows. You only need $1 billion company to trust you for everybody else to trust you. So that's my biggest lesson. You said in 30 seconds, I don't know if that was 30 seconds or not, but two other lessons are, you have to understand that YouTube's primary intent is to keep people on the platform. So the moment you start sending people off session, or you know, if you end their session or watch time session, you actually get penalized and not pushed. And so the game is, how do you keep people on for long enough and then do a call to action where you can actually get your sales in? That's a balance. But if you copy Facebook, it's three posts and then an ad. Three posts and then an ad. So that's a nice way to kind of send people off platform without screwing up your algorithm measurements. And the third lesson I've learned off of YouTube is there's somebody who's willing to take your head off. So what I'm saying is that you have to constantly be growing. If you're not growing, you're dying, quite literally. I'm constantly studying thumbnails and content, and you always have to be like a step ahead of where you were yesterday, or else you're going to fall back. And you not only you fall back, but you have to make up for when you fell back, and then you have to try to move forward. So that wasn't very specific, but as far as like, you know, what I've experienced, that's, you know, that's my answer.
What is it that makes your viewers subscribe to you? So in like a minute or two, like as you said before, everyone has a different different personality, different message, right? But what is it that's attracting almost a million subscribers to your YouTube page? You do videos, a lot of videos, good videos, but what is it that you think, if you can boil it down, that's really making people resonate or emote, as you talked about, with you? Thank you.
Yeah, I think what it comes down to is they realize that I dedicated my entire life to what I'm doing. Not my entire life. I don't know what I'll be doing in 20 years, but I dedicated myself to this. The same way you dedicated yourself to having rooms for years and years and years, and you pop on Clubhouse, you keep seeing the same people. You're like, wow, they live this. And that's why people can trust you enough to follow that journey and subscribe. Because subscribe says, I want to know what's new, what's the next thing. And even if they get the notification bell or not, notifications or not. So to answer your question, it's just because my market had enough problems to solve and I knew how to solve the problems and I was consistent about it, meaning they can trust that I would show up. So that's pretty much it. Like, why does your favorite show come on every Friday at a certain time? You know, it's a ritual. If you study the book Social Code Medium, to look up the actual points from the book, creating a ritual is something that's part of a community. And the reason why a ritual is a part of a community is because it builds trust based on consistent frequency. So if something happens every Friday, you anticipate it for it to happen on Friday because that's your routine. The same way if you guys are in a relationship, routine is the trust. Like if your husband goes to the gym every day for an hour, comes back home at 2, I don't know everybody's schedule, but if the moment your husband goes to the gym and it takes 3 hours, okay, there's no verbal transaction, but the routine is what builds the trust. And so the same thing when it comes to your viewers, routine is a trust element. And that's why people subscribe.
How many videos do you really need to make money on YouTube? So if you can break it down, is there a magic formula for the amount of videos? I know Mr. B said in an interview, he said, make me 100 interviews and then we'll talk. So don't complain until you make 100 videos. So what's right. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I don't know my threshold specifically, but I can tell you it's way over 100. What it comes down to technically is I think 4,000 watch hours and 1,000 subscribers technically, as far as the technicals. Now, everybody's different. Now, this is why I prefaced it earlier by saying there's two types of content. You have interruption-based content, which the primary goal is to get above what's called a 5% click-through rate so that you can get on the homepage and then get pushed by the discovery element of YouTube. 5% click-through rate. Now, how do we, so again, it's interruption-based content, which is very fast viral type stuff. And then you have very slow but grow type of content, which is that educational problem-solving content. Now, you don't grow fast with that. So that's going to take time because it depends on the market cap per the search volume, you know, for your specific thing. But if you're doing interruption-based, I was going to get into those psychological triggers. I just don't want to jump your questions too far, you know, but I would love to go through those psychological triggers real quick because that's when people talk about viral and getting 1 million views and 100,000 views in one video and they post once a week, it's because they've created a primarily entertainment-based audience. And, you know, they have to tell stories. Okay. So when it comes to storytelling, now, if you look at Mr. Beast and all these things, what's the first thing Shakespeare had in his plays? Now, you're going to think it's so obvious, but we overlook it every day. Characters. Okay. So if you don't have a character going through something within a video, meaning multiple characters for your stage play called a video, then it's not going to get that mass appeal. You can Google the hero's journey. The hero basically goes out on a journey. He has a problem that they want to solve. And then he runs into friction. He runs into a polar opposite of himself, a demon, so to speak, or a devil. And then he overcomes the devil. And then he solves a problem. He finds a mentor. And then, you know, he learns something and then repeats the cycle over and over. Now, I'm paraphrasing. But in each video, when you want to get on that level of a storyteller, you know, there's a hero's journey that you want to study. And you also need to just apply the fact that you need characters. Now, most of us are doing the YouTube thing solo. So how do you tie in characters if you're solo? And this is where you either need to pull in celebrity, which people understand as characters, or you have to hit up other YouTubers or friends and pull them in as like small clips and little blurbs here and there to contribute to what you have to do, because that's what people are actually watching. Like, I don't know if there's any Love Island fans in here. And I'll follow your format here in a second. But if you watch Love Island, I watch it with my fiance. There's something called the unseen bits. So they have their reality show. It's about dating and they're all on this island and they try to date each other to figure out who's the best for them. Now, every now and again, they add this filler called unseen bits. Now, the problem with the unseen bits that I just realized is that there's no storytelling. It's just clips of people doing stuff. And then it changes into clips of people doing stuff. Whereas the main show is all about the story. It has characters, it has friction, it has resolution, it has a big reveal. And so you have to tell a story or else it's not going to appeal for people's attention. So again, just make sure you understand the difference between interruption-based folks and then people who are looking to solve a problem. Those are two completely different people, and I just want to be clear.
How do you meet with these YouTube influencers? There's not like an official live stage where you can say, hey, you know, Mr. Beast or PewDiePie, or how do you connect in that realm?
Yeah, I'm a little bit off the grid. I'm just a maverick entrepreneur trying to figure it out from the ground up, from the mud, so to speak. And so there is something called UTA, which is a talent agency that a lot of even musicians are represented by them. So that's how a lot of these podcasts are getting guests. They're going to UTA or some kind of equivalent agency. I think even Mr. Beast used to be on an agency. I forget the name. Nine or something. I forget the name, but a lot of these guys are represented by almost like the equivalent of a record label, but for YouTube, you know, talent agencies. And they do all the work of sponsorships and matching the product and service with the YouTuber and all that type of stuff. The mentality is, you know, on YouTube, we're a lot of independent thinkers most of the time. So there is a contact button, and most people put their real email under the contact button because you have to verify that you're human to reveal it. And the more primal way used to be through a multi-channel network, which again is like a talent agency. But, you know, because of monetization and how people can make money without them, people are kind of moving away from MCN, so to speak. I would highly recommend you just avoid MCNs. It's just like a record label. They're going to push Drake before they push you. So, you know, it's the same person in marketing trying to handle two people. Who are they going to choose, Drake or you? So just use that mentality and common sense. And the reason I say that story is because I lost about 20% of my income for 4 years, which totaled to about $100,000 of YouTube revenue because I was just naive and ignorant and believed somebody. And so I just wanted, not that it's as prevalent today, but just the MCN thing is an archaic approach to YouTube. But that's how you find them is talent agencies.
What is the significance of making great videos to make money on YouTube? So
And it goes back to those definitions. I think there's two main audiences. You have the interruption-based guys, and then you have the education-based folks. With the education-based folks, as long as you solve their problem, they could care less if you record on your webcam and it's 97 pixels wide. And, you know, as long as you solve the problem and show them the step-by-step, that's all they care about. I did it myself. I was in my mom's extra bedroom where I felt like the ceiling to that room was the ceiling to my life. I had nothing but a laptop that I had from university. I figured it out. And so I know that it's the value is not in the presentation, because that's the filler. You know, the value is in, are you solving a problem? That's for the education folks. Now, for the interruption based folks, yes, you want to invest in lighting, like a Godox TL60, I want to think it's called. It's the one I use. I have two rods. They basically create a backlight. So you need to understand backlight, filler light, and then I think they call it main light or something like that. Now, I learned from a guy named Ben Johnson on YouTube. He's the expert. I'm just the guy who's regurgitating what he said. But mainly, you have to have a light behind you because it creates depth. You have to have a light in front of you so that you get more exposed, meaning you become brighter. And then a filler light just helps you not look like, you know, the sun on one side and the dark side of the moon on the other side. So instead of looking like a mask, you want what's called a filler light. And so that's what people do. They usually also add lights above their head to make it, you know, kind of halo effect around their heads, so where you can perceive depth. So to answer your question, though, video quality is only for people who are in that interruption based, because again, to go mass, we need to have a common language, we need to entertain and all those different things. You know, storytelling by Shakespeare, we need to have characters, we need to have a hero's journey, we need to have a professional thumbnail that has contrast, depth, highlights. So go study highlighting on YouTube and glow effect. That's very popular on YouTube right now, the glow effect and highlights. You need to, you know, I can go into the psychological triggers, which are the real secret behind all this, but the video itself, again, if you just took all the footage and slapped it together in one long thing, it's not a Mr. Beast video. What makes it a Mr. Beast video is the editing, it's the formatting. And so, you know, we usually introduce, the way he could hook people in is introduce people to a big reveal or the anticipation for a big reveal right away. So the way I taught Dr. Finance this is, if you're doing a YouTube short, for example, edit your YouTube short, cut the ending off, and then put the ending in the beginning of the video. So when people start the video, they're seeing the ending, and then it restarts, and then you say your intro. And it's like a perfect loop effect. And so what I'm trying to get at is, you know, watch any of your favorite reality shows, whether it's Love Island, whatever, and watch how they introduce the show, and you'll realize they introduce the points that you're going to be waiting for. Oh, she's about to fight with so-and-so. Oh, this person gets mad. Oh, this person, you know, betrays this person. And so you can copy the stories from the Bible, whether it's betrayal stories, war stories. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. You just need to understand that we're talking to two different communities. And, I just want people to focus on the community that will always be there, which is your problem-solving community. Once you start getting into interruption-based content and communities, you're going to be chasing the wind, because at the drop of a dime, they could change and say, I don't like you, and go to another creator. They're not based in anything except for the story. Okay, so that's why I keep harping on that so much.
Do we need views to make money?
Now, if you're talking through their ad model, yes. But it depends on your specific niche. But most people here aren't talking about credit cards and finance. And so their CPM is going to be way lower or way below somebody who is talking about, you know, companies that could spend billions of dollars just to get a YouTube. I'm exaggerating. But companies that can spend multi-millions on a YouTube campaign and throw it away, like a credit card company, pharma, you know, all those kind of topics are, they have a bigger pockets to spend. Now, if you're in a smaller niche, you know, I think I'm trying to find my CPM right now. I think I'm around 15 bucks cost per milli, which is, you know, if you want to talk to 1,000 people, it costs you $15, like that. And that's how YouTube sells it to the advertisers. So if your CPM is high, around $15, for example, you would need, you know, my YouTube makes about 4,500 on this YouTube tab, but it, you know, when they actually pay you on Google AdSense, you not only get your live stream revenue, you also get, sometimes it's way higher than what they list. So when I'm averaging about 5,000 for the current 9-month cycle on YouTube, for example, you know, that's based off of a $15 CPM. You know, the people who buy ads on my channels are usually the audio companies. And so they're not tech companies where they can spend a gazillion dollars. So, I mean, it, you know, the bidding stops at a certain point. So to answer your question, yes, views, but less views and a higher CPM means you don't need to worry about views as much. But most people aren't in that niche to where they can get lower views and still get paid the same way. So yes, views is my answer to you.
But is there a magic video duration to get views?
Yeah, you know, what supersedes that is the format. You know, I have minute long videos where the retention is almost above 90% or 80% and above. So what YouTube cares about is more so how much of the video somebody's watching. But to answer your question, you know, I have a YouTube short that has 2 million views and it earned what, $50. So views don't always mean you're getting paid heavy on YouTube. There's a fine line as a content creator. You have to serve the YouTube platform. What's the goal of the YouTube platform? To get advertisers. So that means you have to talk the keywords that advertisers are actually trying to, monetize, or, you know, what's the word? Advertise and use, or target, that's the word I'm looking for. So if I'm using a bunch of keywords that an advertiser would never use in their marketing campaign, I'm not gonna get any of that money because that's not what the advertiser's looking for to distribute their ad. So you have to, one, satisfy the needs of the advertiser. The way you learn that is you type in your keyword into Google Keyword Planner. And this will give you all the keywords that most people use as their target keywords. And so that's a quicker way to get monetized, is just focus on what a marketer would do. And so you have to satisfy the advertisers by doing, you know, targeting their specific keyword, but also you need to get views from your audience. And again, how do you expand? Most people are probably stuck here. They understand YouTube to a degree, but they're stuck. The reason you're stuck is because your niche has an actual cap to it, and you need to go mass. How do you go mass? You introduce curiosity and you introduce topics that are more common. Like, instead of me talking about how to sound design a snare in Serum, you're like, what is he even talking about? Okay, then I can go up a level and say how to sound design a snare. Okay, some more people may understand what I'm talking about. Then I go, how to make a snare. Now, for an average person here, they might not even know what a snare is. So I say music industry sound design secrets. And now more people can understand, because I'm not watering down, but I'm changing my language to target a bigger and bigger market. And if you keep using keywords that target small markets, you're not going to get big numbers. And it takes a lot of work and research. To give you bullet points, go to vidIQ. They have a keyword search tool. You'll be surprised how many keywords are like getting millions and millions of views. Just literally go to vidIQ.com, make an account. It's $50 a month. If you can't do vidIQ, then look at the top, top YouTubers in your space. Go to their top videos, rank it by popular. And then I think it's called Inspect. You can right click and, view page source, okay, on Google Chrome. And then hit Control F to search and look up the word keywords. And it will give you the keywords of that video. And all you have to do is go to the top 10 videos, list all their keywords, and put them into a document. And you'll start to realize the keywords that actually bring people traffic. And then the game becomes, how do I compete and make my content fit around a specific keyword? Because that keyword is what, you know, if people are searching, that's what drives the traffic for them to even go down this pathway. So I think there's a lot of, I'm trying to shorten my thoughts, but there's a lot of false correlation when it comes to people hopping on YouTube.
You have to actually state the keyword, or should it be an SEO form where it's built into the description, built into the tags?
Yeah, if you actually go to, I think it's called Google Vision. I might be a little dated on that. This was in the book by Daryl Eves called YouTube Formula. Go to Google Vision. You'll realize that Google has the ability to tell what's in a thumbnail before you even tell it what's in a thumbnail. And this is so they can prevent against, you know, adult material ending up on their platform and different things and malicious content. And so they already know what's in your thumbnail. I learned this way back when Facebook did it too. But they already know what's in your thumbnail. They already know what's in your content, regardless of the SEO stuff that you use. So, you know, that's why they can pull up the subtitles. It's because they have speech recognition AI or whatever they use to figure out what you're saying. And so nowadays it's more so, are you mentioning it in the video? Because the SEO stuff, you know, people can fake that and manipulate that. And the one thing people can't manipulate are their eyeballs on a screen and what are people actually saying in the video or showing in the video. And they figured out the technology to detect that. So that supersedes any tags or keywords. What makes people click are those triggers. You know, and I would love to share the triggers real quick because I know we have a little bit of time. I'll just speed read these, so bear with me. Okay, it's pain aversion, meaning, you know, what are the biggest mistakes they can avoid? Community, This also ties to a personality type called the N personality type. I don't have time for that to explain. But then we have common enemy, you know, positioning somebody against the community. Then you have gaining pleasure, how somebody can watch a video and gain a desired outcome. Then you have celebrity, using Drake's name, 50 Cent's name, Snoop Dogg's name in your title. You also have current events, Halloween, you know, Christmas, Valentine's Day, blah, blah, blah. Current events are always hot topics. New things, novelty, we humans are designed to follow the unknowns. And that's what the human, that's what the hero's journey is all about, actually, if you study it deeper. Okay, so novelty, the new this, the new that, the new plugin, the new whatever. So explain why. This is also a psychological technique. Because if you say something like, I'll show you how to make $1 million in this video, and you don't explain why, people don't believe you because you haven't justified or balanced a promise that you're making. So always explain why and show your intent. Tell a story. I already showed you guys, you know, study Shakespeare, the hero's journey. You need characters in your videos if you want to truly tell a story. Simple and easy is also a tactic. Curiosity, I showed you how to take the spectator over to a skeptic by introducing curiosity and the unknowns and mystery. Anticipation, these are called open loops, okay? The same way you train a dog to sit. You know, you don't give them the treat until they sit. That's called anticipation. It's called Pavlovian response. You start building that Pavlovian response, then you create what's called ritual. And so anticipation is used to keep people there, and you know, ritual is the repetition of that Pavlovian response. You have social proof, which is, you know, if you see a guy who has 950,000 subscribers, you assume that he's telling the truth. We humans don't have time to judge everything about everything. And so we look to the people who have studied the everything about everything so that we can look to their decision the same way in politics. So social proof matters. Relative perspective means you need to have a contrast. In Robert Cialdini's audiobook, he talks about how if you have a $200 product, introduce a $2,000 product so that when by the time you say the $200 product, it's like, whew, okay, cool, $200, I could do that. So you want to use that when it comes to length of video, topics of the video, how deep you're going into your video. There's different psychological ways to do that. Then you have scarcity, which is like limited time, limited quantity. You know, this video will disappear in 24 hours. Create urgency that way. And lastly, you have controversy, which I would not recommend at all. Controversy did give me a lot of followers, but it just brings in a very low frequency. So I would not recommend controversy. So I got to be careful talking about that one.
From what you know about Clubhouse, what you know about YouTube, is there a way to utilize the same skill sets to become a master at that platform and and be rewarded over there? What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think the ultimate for people like this, you know, podcasting and cross-pollination is the key to hypergrowth. You know, like Jesus said, or whoever said it, I forget, it's a Bible, so it's in the Bible somewhere. You could either take the two hands you have and fish with a rod and catch one fish at a time, or you could throw the same, use the same two hands to throw a net and then catch a lot of fish at a time. And all I'm saying that is that's leverage. And so folks like yourselves, because you're not just talking to one person, you're talking to a million people, because the conversations we have here, I can articulate over to the platform and then that could get picked up over time. So it's not just talking to one person. So I like to look at people, not because they're more important or less important because of their following, but everybody you see, calculate their followers. I mean, it's the only quantitative number we have, and just say, I'm not talking to one person. I'm talking to 50,000 when I have this conversation with X, Y, and Z. And the more you kind of think of it that way, you'll make your conversations more important and you may get invited to podcasts. I mean, not everybody has a valuable story for a specific community, but yes, it can translate, but it's going to take a lot more effort. I can't say effort, but a lot more skill. Again, I don't want to offend anybody. YouTube is not just jump in and just you're going to be successful. It's just a lot of little things that you have to learn over time. So I'm not trying to discourage people, but I'm not also trying to create a false expectation.